Ah, coffee. There are so many ways to enjoy it. But how is it made? The process starts all the way at the plantation. What we call coffee beans are actually the seeds of trees such as Coffea arabica, the source of around 70% of the world's coffee. Around 30% comes from Coffea canephora, or Robusta trees. There's also the less common Liberica and Excelsa trees, making up a few percent of the world's coffee source. You can't just grow these trees anywhere. Their fruit thrives in higher, cooler areas of the tropics, specifically at temperatures of 64 to 70 degrees Fahrenheit. The fruits can then ripen slowly, allowing them to develop deeper, richer flavors. Continuous exposure to temperatures of around 86 degrees Fahrenheit can lead to faster ripening, which damages the coffee plants, stunting growth, yellowing leaves, and even leading to diseases like rust. Warmer temperatures also mean more pests. The next step is harvesting the beans. It takes about 3 to 5 years after planting for the trees to start bearing fruit. The fruit, called the coffee cherry, is ripe and ready to be harvested when it turns a bright, deep red. Workers then begin the harvest. This is done by hand in most countries, but Brazil's mostly flat terrain allows them to mechanize the process. Once the fruits are harvested, processing begins. This is when the coffee beans are extracted from the fruit. The traditional method of processing coffee fruit is the dry process, where the cherries are spread out to dry in the sun before the pulp is removed. In the wet process, the pulp is first removed from the coffee cherries. Then the beans are placed in water-filled fermentation tanks to remove any pectin still attached to the beans. When fermentation is complete, the beans are rinsed and then dried. To dry their fruits, larger plantations often opt to use mechanical drying machines in order to offer coffee producers greater precision and control over the quality of their batches. Machines can also help speed up the process, as drying can take up to 4 weeks without the help of machines. The final step of processing coffee is milling, separating the dried out husks of the fruit, or the parchment layer, from the bean. This step is mostly done with the help of machines called hullers. They use a combination of air and friction to quickly extract the bean from the dried remains of the fruit. After this stage, the beans may be polished to remove any skin that remains after hulling. There is then a final round of grading and sorting by color, size, and quality. The beans are also examined for any flaws or other imperfections. Once this is done, it's time to roast the beans. This is where the green coffee beans are transformed to give them their distinct, rich, brown color and aroma. Industrial roasting employs the use of a large preheated drum. Coffee is typically roasted at temperatures of between 350 and 500 degrees Fahrenheit. When the beans reach an internal temperature of around 400 degrees Fahrenheit, they begin to turn brown, and the cafeol, a fragrant oil locked inside the beans, begins to emerge. This is why the amount of time the bean is roasted can drastically affect its flavor. Light roasts produce a tangier, sweeter brew. Dark roasts bring out the deeper, bitter flavors of the beans. The penultimate step is grinding the beans. Whether this is done in a factory in a large industrial grinder or at home in your personal one, the basic principle is the same. However, if you intend to do this at home, it's important to note that the size of the coffee grounds can have a significant effect on the overall taste of your brew, depending on the method used to brew the coffee. Too coarse of a grind can lead to your cup tasting sour, acidic, and salty. On the other hand, grinding your coffee too fine can lead to a bitter, bland cup. And now for the last step, brewing your coffee. Regardless of how it's done, whether it's with a fancy espresso machine or a simple pour-over, the basic principle is the same. Water is used to extract flavors from the grounds. Many factors can affect the taste of your cup of coffee at this stage, such as the mineral content of the water used, the bean-to-water ratio, the amount of time the coffee is left to brew, and the temperature of the water. Variations in any one of these can lead to wide differences in the final product, regardless of the quality of the actual bean. It's easy to take this everyday drink and all of the hard work that goes into producing it for granted. So the next time you have a cup of coffee, maybe take a moment to savor the journey it took from bean to cup.